Desert Island Discs. Each week, a well-known person is asked the question, if you were to be cast away alone on a desert island, which 8 gramophone records would you choose to have with you? As usual, the castaway is introduced by Roy Plumley.
Our castaway this week is an American musician, and a very versatile musician. It's André Previn. Mr. Previn, could you reconcile yourself to indefinite loneliness?
Well, I suppose I could. I have never been terribly gregarious. I love to be with friends, but I don't need a city kind of life. Of course, there's quite a difference between a city and being marooned, isn't there? But I suppose I could cope with it. I'm terribly optimistic about things, and I think that would not leave me.
What would you be happiest to have got away from?
Well, I know this may sound like a joke, but I would be happiest to get away from the telephone, which I think interrupts work, leisure, rest, whatever.
What was the principal motivation in choosing your 8 records? Was it remembrance of things past, great performances, music for music's sake? What?
Well, I think it's all a part of those. I think it's simply a matter of not being able to do without these specific 8. You know, you've given me a great many sleepless nights because I think my first list ran to 164 and to pare it down is not easy, but these are among the 8 works which I simply couldn't fathom doing without.
What's the first one?
The first one is the Mozart Symphony No. 40, G minor.
Why do you choose this?
Well, first of all, and quite generally speaking, I think Mozart is the musical equivalent of Shakespeare, meaning it's the cornerstone. I couldn't do without it. And as a conductor, I would choose a symphony, and this, I think, is in many ways the perfect piece.
Opening of the Mozart Symphony No. 40 in G minor, Cellini conducting the new Philharmonia Orchestra. What's your second choice?
My second choice still remains with Mozart, but this time chamber music. You can't be on a desert island without chamber music. Besides which, the chances are you can always get 4 more people marooned, but not a whole orchestra. And this is the slow movement of the G minor quintet.
Mm-hmm. G minor again.
Yes, but that's ask Mozart why, not me.
Thank you. beginning of the third movement of the Mozart G minor quintet, the Amadeus String Quartet with Cecil Aronowitz. Mr. Previn, were you born in the United States?
No, I was born in Germany, in Berlin, went over to the United States in about 1939.
Do you come from a musical family?
Only by interest. I mean, my father was a very, very good amateur pianist and even gave lessons mm-hmm. once we went to the United States, but no one in my family had ever been a professional, no.
Yeah. So you heard a lot of music as a child?
Oh, yes, from the earliest recollection I have, I remember chamber music in the house quite constantly, several times a week.
Yes. Were you put to the piano or did you go to it?
Well, I'm told I went to it, which sounds kind of smug and awful, but I suppose I did. Yes, I asked for lessons.
Mm-hmm. So when your family went to the United States, you carried on with your lessons, of course. When did you decide that music was to be your career?
I don't think I ever had any choice about it. Mm-hmm. I was stuck in the conservatory at a very early age and didn't see fresh air for about 10 years, you know, so it never occurred to me to be anything else.
Mm-hmm. When did you start as a professional?
As a professional, by which you mean that I got paid for what I did?
Yes.
Approximately when I was 16.
Doing what?
Well, strangely enough, I became an orchestrator at MGM Studios in Hollywood.
Yes. In those days, MGM was the home of the big glossy musicals.
Oh, yes, I wrote endless, harp glisses for Esther Williams Swimming. And but I was an orchestrator for 3 years, orchestrating other people's music, and yes. Then I was given my own films.
I know you've won 4 Oscars for scoring musicals. Which were they?
Let's see, they were Gigi, Porgy and Bess, Irma La Douce, and My Fair Lady.
Mm-hmm. Now, which of the many film scores that you've composed do you like to remember?
I don't really like to remember a great many of them. I've done probably more bad films than any composer you've ever spoken to, but there were a few that I liked, and they all go quite a way back. I liked an early Spencer Tracy movie called Bad Day at Black Rock. I liked a movie called Elmer Gantry. And there was a really horrendous movie called The Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse, to which I wrote a score, of which I'm occasionally fond.
Yes. Now, although your main musical interest lie elsewhere nowadays, you still write film music occasionally.
Yes, by now with my conducting schedule and abstract composing schedule, I only have time for about one a year.
Yes. Do you like the discipline of it?
Well, I like the application of the technique a lot, yes, and I do enjoy scoring films, but not to the exclusion of other things.
Mm-hmm. You've just written an original screen musical.
Yes, my wife and I just wrote an original screen musical on Goodbye, Mr. Chips, and that's finished, and we'll go into production soon, and now we're starting on the same kind of work on Great Expectations.
Yes. Your wife does the lyrics?
My wife does the lyrics, and she also writes an occasional libretto, although in these cases, Terence Rattigan wrote the screenplay to Goodbye, Mr. Chips.
Did you meet your wife professionally at the studios?
Yes, I met her professionally, and I think we worked together for about a full year before I ever asked her out to dinner.
Let's have your third record. What next?
All right, well, we're still with Mozart. This is my favorite Mozart piano concerto, the C minor, K491, and this is the beginning of the last movement.
Mm-hmm. This is a work you played many times in the concert hall yourself.
Well, yes. You see, by now, I've kept up my piano playing, hopefully, but not to the degree where I go out and I'm a recitalist. You know, it's impossible for me. But occasionally I will play and conduct from the keyboard, and I love to play chamber music. And this is one of the concertos that, of course, is quite feasible to do from the keyboard. But I must say that the performance we're about to hear is infinitely better because it's by my favorite pianist, Solomon.
Solomon as soloist in Mozart's Piano Concerto No. 24, the beginning of the third movement. Now, apart from knowing your name as a familiar one on motion picture credit titles, we first came to know you in this country on records as an outstanding jazz pianist. Have you lost interest in jazz now?
No, I haven't lost interest as a musician at all, but I've lost interest in terms of having to play it, because, you see, I was never a jazz musician. I like to think of myself as a musician who also played jazz. And now, with the amount of conducting that I'm doing, it would be simply impossible in terms of the calendar to add any other form of music to it. I had to make up my mind what to me was expendable, and I'm afraid the jazz was it.
Yes. How long ago did you have to make that decision?
About 6 years ago.
And since then, you've conducted pretty well every major American orchestra.
Yes, I think so.
You're now conductor-in-chief of one of the orchestras.
Yes, of the Houston Symphony in Texas, and it's a very frightening thing for me, because the last three conductors they've had have been Sir Thomas Beecham, Stokowski, and Sir John Barbaroli, so do keep your fingers crossed for me, won't you?
I will indeed. Well, this year you made your very successful debut as a conductor in London.
Yes, with the London Symphony Orchestra last spring.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the orchestra with which I do all my recordings.
You've also conducted your first concert in a number of other European cities this year.
Yes, in Holland and Sweden and Denmark, and I'm planning on quite a few other places to go.
Mm-hmm. Rather surprisingly, although you're known best perhaps for conducting 20th century music, you gave us in London first a mainly Mozart program.
Well, that's my predilection. You know, there's a great deal of self-indulgence in conducting, I think, and which is as it should be, and I would rather conduct Mozart than anything. But for my opening concert in the Houston season, I have a program that I hope typifies the season, and that is that I'm doing a new symphony by William Schumann, the contemporary American composer,
mm-hmm.
and Beethoven 5, and there, kind of as an example, is what I would like the seasons to be.
What's your next record? What's number four?
Well, aptly, the Beethoven 5. See, it's very difficult for me to leave out the Beethoven 5th as a conductor, because it is, I think, the perfect piece. It's the most perfectly constructed piece of symphonic writing I know, and I would hate to have to do without it, and this is the beginning of the first movement. Thank you.
Kleiber conducting the Concertgebouw Orchestra of Amsterdam in the opening of Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. Now, with the exception of your films, Mr. Previn, we haven't talked about your work as a composer. What have been your principal compositions?
Well, to tell you the truth, the only ones that I would even speak about were the ones that I'm currently involved in. And I just last month finished a rather lengthy cello concerto, which will be premiered in Houston in approximately 6 weeks' time by the principal cellist. Poor fellow, he's got no choice, you know. I gave it to him to learn. And then hopefully will be played in Europe next year. And I'm in the process right now of writing some songs for soprano and orchestra.
Mm-hmm.
And that being current is really the only work in which I'm very interested.
You've been working on a new Broadway musical.
Yes, that's on the other side of the coin now, and I'm very fortunate because my partner in that is Alan Lerner, who of course wrote My Fair Lady, among other things. And that's a play called Coco, which will be based loosely on the career of Coco Chanel, the designer, and that will be on next season on Broadway.
You're one of the few musicians who works with equal facility at every musical level, from jazz to the concert hall, with film music in the middle. Do you think it's easier to find acceptance at all those levels in the United States than it is here?
Oh, no, I find it infinitely easier here. Because in the United States, I think anyone who is never mind working in films, I think anyone who's ever flown over Hollywood in an airplane is looked at with alarm and suspicion. But here, one of the reasons I find this such a terribly pleasurable place to work is that I find that one is judged, whether concerts or records, only by what that particular concert or record has within it and not on how one spends or misspends one's youth.
Do you find the musical scene more exciting here than it is in America?
Well, I find London the most stimulating city in the world as a musician, so much so that I'm planning on moving here permanently.
Are you?
Yes, it'll take me a few years to get sorted out, but then I will.
Mm. This is a corny question, Mr. Previn, but your musical ambition, if the telephone were to ring now with an offer, a suggestion, what would you like it to be?
Ah, totally selfish, you mean?
Yes.
Well, that's very simple. I would like to be offered the conductor-in-chief of the London Symphony.
Well, that's a very flattering thing to say.
Well, it would be a very flattering thing to have happen.
Right, let's have record number 5.
We're still with Beethoven, and this is the 4th piano concerto, the G major, and this is one of my favorite bits, which is coming out of the cadenza in the first movement into that really lovely ending, and this again is Mr. Solomon.
End of the first movement of Beethoven's 4th piano concerto with Solomon as soloist, which brings us now to your 6th record.
Well, I couldn't very well live for the rest of my life without hearing a Brahms symphony. And although each Brahms symphony, I think the best one is always the one I've just heard, this one in particular would be the ending of the last movement of the fourth.
Closing passage of the Brahms Fourth Symphony, Karajan conducting the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra. Now, we've dumped you on this desert island, Mr. Previn. How well would you be able to look after yourself?
You mean from a practical point of view?
From a practical point of view.
Hopeless. Hopeless. Not at all. I can't even change a light bulb without exploding the house or make a sandwich without slicing my finger off. I am really, and it's not an affectation, I am a complete cripple when it comes to anything practical at all.
No shelter?
No.
No cultivation?
You mean on the island?
On the island.
No, I think I'd have to look for, you know, a hollow tree or something. I read these things I remember from my childhood, you know, the Swiss Family Robinson and all that, and it's just complete fantasy.
Right, no boat building. Suppose a raft was washed up. Would you try to escape on it? Would you do a contiki?
Oh, no, I don't think so. I think one must have more than just a beard and willingness to go on Kontiki. I think I would simply wait and trust to my optimism that someone would eventually come by.
Yes. Right, now your hobbies, you have no practical hobbies. Do you have any other hobbies? Do you collect anything?
Yes, I collect paintings, and my wife and I have a rather nice collection.
Yes, modern paintings?
Yes, modern paintings in point, mostly American paintings, but quite good.
Do you paint yourself at all?
No, I'm much too fond of pictures to paint myself.
Any other occupations?
No, you mean in terms of a hobby?
Yes.
No, I don't suppose so. I think the only sport that I practice with the slightest amount of finesse is fencing, of all things. Mm-hmm. I do go fencing a lot, but that, of course, for one has to have a partner, so that won't do me much good.
Well, let's get back to music, but your seventh record.
The seventh record, I think it's time for me to indulge myself in some very glamorous orchestral sounds, and this would be the end of La Mer.
Mm-hmm. Debussy's La Mer, played by the New York Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Leonard Bernstein. Now we come to your last record.
The last record, I wanted to be contemporary, and in my own opinion, I think the greatest living composer is Benjamin Britten. And so I picked at random from his War Requiem, which I think is the most admirable piece in my memory, of contemporary works, and this would be the beginning of the Dies Irae.
Mm-hmm. I believe you're going to do this work in Houston.
Yes, yes, I'm terribly pleased about that, and I'm looking forward to it. It's quite a piece to try and put on, but I will be hopefully given extra rehearsals, and I will hopefully not disgrace Mr. Britten.
Opening of the Dies Irae from the Benjamin Britten War Requiem. Mr. Previn, if you could take only one of the eight records you played, if seven of them slipped into the surf, which one would you like left?
Oh, that's impossible. Do you know what I'd do? I think I'd chuck the eighth one after the other seven and just think about all eight. I don't think I could keep one, no.
I think that's a very sensible answer. One luxury to take to the island with you.
Inanimate?
Inanimate.
I see. Well, I suppose in that case it would be a piano.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a cheat, or may I have that?
No, of course you can have that. Yes, we all stipulate it must be an upright one because you can live under a grand.
Ah, very good. Yes, I hadn't thought of that. I suppose, yes, then I would have a piano.
Yes. Do you prepare the works that you're going to conduct on the piano?
Yes, I will study them for quite a bit first, silently, and then I will, especially with contemporary scores, try to play them through from the score. And the same thing with composing. I will compose away from the piano, but I like to have access to one to check it out later.
Mm-hmm. And one book, leaving aside the Bible and Shakespeare, which we assume are already on the island.
Well, that's very difficult indeed, because I thought of taking the Joyce Ulysses or even War and Peace, but with Shakespeare there, that should keep me occupied with all the literary field that I want. So I think, if I may, I would like to have some huge collection of reproduction of paintings.
Mm-hmm. Of all times, of all periods?
Oh, yes, a very big book indeed, yes.
All right, the biggest we can find. And thank you, André Previn, for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
Thank you so much.
Goodbye, everyone.
The guest in today's program was André Previn. The interviewer was Roy Plumley, and the producer, Monica Chapman.